In the last video, we were introduced to node voltage analysis. The basic idea was that we could define all the voltages in a circuit relative to a common point or reference node. Then, using the fact that voltage divided by resistance is current, we could write Kirchhoff's current law equations expressing each of the currents in terms of node voltages. The big deal about this type of analysis is that it works for every circuit. So if we master this technique, we'll be able to solve every circuit, assuming we understand all of the components in a circuit. There are a couple different situations that we might encounter that we don't know how to handle quite yet. By the end of this video, there shouldn't be anything you can't handle. Well, as far as node voltage analysis is concerned. I introduced node voltage analysis to you in the last video. We analyzed a fairly straightforward circuit. Let's look at a couple of wrinkles that we can encounter. In the circuits we dealt with in the last video, we dealt directly with currents only. Quite often, we have voltage sources in the circuit. At this point, we do not necessarily know how to deal with that. Take the following circuit, for example. We have a 2.9 milliamp source in parallel with a 4 kilo ohm resistor. Another 5 kilo ohm resistor will go out and we'll end up with a 28 volt source. I'll begin this problem by outlining the nodes. I'll cross only at each element and follow the wire until I come back to the beginning. This makes it very easy to identify the nodes. Next, I'll select one of these nodes and make it the reference node. The reference node we define as 0 volts for this circuit. Now normally I'd go through and assign a variable for the voltage at each of the remaining nodes. However, in this case, I have a 28 volt source connected to the reference node. If this terminal is at 0 volts, and the voltage has increased by 28 volts from the source, this means that this node must be at 28 volts. That's all we need to do in order to deal with a voltage source, which is connected to the reference node. I'll then go and call the other node VA. Let's define the directions for the currents. Whatever direction we take is fine as long as we follow through consistently when it comes time to writing the equations. I happen to have drawn this so no currents enter node A. Everything will be fine as long as we handle the polarities correctly when we write the equation for current. Starting with the 2.9 milliamp source that leaves the node, the current through the 4 kilo ohm resistor will be VA minus the 0 volt reference node over 4 kilo ohms. Then we have the current through the 5 kilo ohm resistor. Again, it is VA minus 28 volts over 5 kilo ohms. Always remember when we are writing the voltages, it's the voltage at the tail of the current arrow minus the voltage at the head of the current arrow. Our circuit analysis at this point is done. We just have algebra. To simplify things, I'll start by multiplying through by 20 kilo ohms. We end up with 58 volts plus 5 times VA plus 4 times VA minus 112 volts. This simplifies to 9 VA equals 54. So VA equals 6 volts. If we then wanted to determine the current through the 4 kilo ohm resistor, we could write 6 volts minus 0 volts divided by 4 kilo ohms, resulting in a current of 1.5 milliamps. Another situation we may encounter is having two or more voltage sources in a circuit, with at least one of them not connected to a reference node. This circuit is an example of that. Let's make the goal of this problem to determine V sub O. Let's begin this problem in the same way I begin most problems, by outlining the nodes to make them easy to identify. Then we will assign a reference node. Whenever there are voltage sources in a circuit, it is helpful to assign the reference node so that it is connected to at least one of the voltage sources, as it reduces the number of unknown node voltages in the circuit. The reference node is at 0 volts. So if I cross a 15 volt supply traveling from the reference node, this node must be at 15 volts. We cannot do the same thing for the other voltage source, however, because we do not know what the voltage at this node is relative to the reference node. It has already been assigned a variable because VO is between the reference node and this node. We can assign the remaining node a variable since it has not been defined by the problem. Let's call it VA. The challenge in this problem is the 6 volt source. An ideal voltage source can supply any current necessary for the circuit it is connected to. That means there is no current voltage relationship for a source. So we cannot directly write node equations at nodes O and A. We should recall the more formal statement of Kirchhoff's current law. It states that currents entering and leaving a closed boundary must sum to zero. If we treat the 6 volt source as a boundary rather than an element, we can write node equations for all the currents that enter and leave the voltage source, and KCL will still be true. Sometimes this boundary is called a supernode. Before proceeding, we should define the current directions for our unknown currents. The assignment of direction for the currents on the left-hand side of the circuit is arbitrary, since only the node voltages are defined. However, the direction of the current through the 12 kilo-ohm resistor has already been defined by the voltage VO. In a resistor, the current flows from the terminal assigned the positive sign to the terminal assigned the negative sign of the voltage. This, once again, is the passive sign convention. To apply KCL at the 6-volt source, we simply set the currents that enter the source equal to the currents that leave the source. Applying KCL at that source, we have one current that enters the node, 15 volts minus VA over 3 kiloohms. This must equal the currents that leave the voltage source. First, the current through the 6 kiloohm resistor can be written as VA minus 0 volts over 6 kiloohms. Then the current leaving the other side of the voltage source can be written as VO minus the 0 volt reference node over 12 kiloohms. Right now we have one equation with two unknowns. The second equation will come from the 6 volt voltage source itself. A voltage source connected between two nodes defines the difference in potential between those nodes, so that VA, the higher voltage, minus VO, the lower voltage, has to be equal to 6 volts. Now we have an algebra problem. If we take these two equations, we can simplify the first by multiplying through it by 12 kiloohms. This results in 60 volts minus 4 VA equals 2 VA plus VO. Rearranging, we get 60 volts equals 6 times VA minus VO. With a linear system of equations, we can eliminate variables by simply adding the equations together. If we add these two equations together, we get 66 volts equals 7 VA, which results in VA equal to 9.43 volts. Then, since VA minus VO is 6 volts, we can solve for VO, which is equal to 3.43 volts. So now we have two examples of node voltage analysis that have included voltage sources. These examples were obviously to demonstrate a simple principle. What if we had to deal with a more complex circuit? Maybe one with dependent sources and floating voltage supplies? Something like this. We apply the same exact procedure as far as the circuit analysis is concerned. I'll start by highlighting the nodes to make sure we can clearly identify them. In this circuit, we have 5 nodes. We'll then choose a reference node and assign it 0 volts. We can then go on and determine if any nodes are already defined. This node is connected to a 10-volt source. That is connected to the reference node. Therefore, the voltage here is 10 volts. We can assign the remaining nodes variables, as they are not defined relative to the reference node. The next step will be to assign directions to any undefined currents. Those would be the current through the 3 kiloohm resistor, the current through the 5 kiloohm resistor, and the current through the 11 kiloohm resistor. The current through the 7 kiloohm resistor is already defined as IZ. Now let's start looking at the undefined nodes. The node defined by V1 is connected to a dependent voltage source that is not connected to the reference node. So we cannot write a node voltage, nor can we write a direct KCL equation. The same is true for the node identified by V2. If we remember the last example, we can still get two equations from nodes 1 and 2 if we look at them together. First, the difference in electric potential between the nodes must be equal to the value of the voltage source. We take the higher voltage V1 minus the lower voltage V2 and set it equal to 17 kiloohms times IZ. Then we can write a node equation for all the currents that enter or leave the voltage source. The current through the 3 kiloohm resistor enters the node and can be written as 10 volts minus V1 divided by 3 kiloohms. That's the only current that enters and must be equal to the two that leave. The current through the 11 kiloohm resistor leaves the node and can be written as V2 minus 0 volts divided by 11 kiloohms. The other current that leaves is the dependent current source. It has a current of 13 millisiemens times Vx. Let's set these two equations aside for later. If we look at node 3, one current enters and two leave. The current that enters is the 13 millisiemens times Vx. The currents that leave are the current through the 7 kiloohm resistor, which we'll write as V3 minus 0 volts divided by 7 kiloohms, and the current through the 5 kiloohm resistor, which we will write as V3 minus 10 volts divided by 5 kiloohms. That node equation is complete, Let's set that equation aside for later. We then have to deal with the dependent sources. The special thing we have to do to handle dependent sources is to write the controlling parameter in terms of node voltages. The controlling parameter is the current or voltage that the dependent source is dependent upon. In the case of the dependent voltage source, it is IZ. IZ is the current through the 7 kilo ohm resistor, which we can write as V3 minus 0 volts over 7 kilo ohms. The dependent current source is controlled by the voltage Vx. Vx is connected between the nodes defined by V3 and the 10-volt source. If we subtract the higher voltage from the lower voltage, we'll get Vx equals V3 minus 10 volts. This is a voltage, so we don't have to worry about the value of the resistor. We can add these two equations to our collection. Now we have five equations with five unknowns. This system of equations is not as neat and tidy as the previous two systems were, so we may have to approach how we solve this system a little differently. With larger systems of equations, there are better tools than algebraic substitution. In fact, to solve this system, we're going to use matrices. Our first step is to set this up for matrix calculation is to separate terms that contain variables and the ones that contain numbers. I'll start by gathering the terms that contain the variables to the left side of the equation. Then we can go through the equations and remove any numeric values to the right side. I'll also remove any irrelevant zeros and arrange the equation so the variables all appear in the same order. First equation remains unchanged. The second one becomes this. The third becomes this. The fourth equation is mostly unchanged, simply reordered. And the last equation will get reordered. In order to put the system of equations into a matrix form, we'll need to have coefficients for all the variables in each equation, even if those coefficients are zero. So let's go through the system of equations and write the equations in terms of coefficients and variables. The first equation becomes this, the second this, the third, and so on. Now we have a set of coefficients highlighted in yellow that modify the variables. We also have a set of coefficients that represent the constants. These are highlighted in green. The system of equations written in matrix form looks like this. If you don't remember why or how we can do this, you may need to go and pull out your old algebra book. To solve using a calculator, we'll enter in the 5x5 coefficient matrix, then enter the column vector of the numbers on the right side of the equation. If we apply the inverse matrix of A to both sides, we'll have a column vector of the variables and a column vector of the solutions. These column vectors represent the solution to each of the unknown voltages and currents. This video took a little bit longer than I expected, and it was a little more intense than the previous topics. However, remember that even though the equations and algebra got a little bit more complicated, the basic procedure was the same. We just did the same thing more times. Another important thing I've noticed over the years of teaching is that when the systems get more complicated, it is helpful to reduce the number of steps we take to get to the solution. That is why with a 5x5 system, I didn't do any computation until I was ready to invert the matrix. The less I mess with the equation, the less chance there is I'll make a silly arithmetic or algebra error. So that's all there is to nodal analysis. You identify the nodes, you select a reference node, determine any voltages that are defined by voltage sources, you pick variables for the unknown voltages, pick directions for the unknown currents, write KCL equations, and if you have dependent sources, write the controlling parameter in terms of the node voltages. After that, pull out your favorite method for solving systems of equations and get a solution. Thanks for watching. Until next time, go out and make it a great one.